surrounding. Then immediately, it goes into another story. And this next story, which takes up basically the bottom of chapter 5, is sometimes called a Markham sandwich, because it's kind of one story with a top and a bottom, and then another story, a secondary story, sandwiched in the middle. It starts with the story of Jesus raising the dead girl. It's the time when the raised till the end of it. But it's the story of Jairus, who's a synagogue believer. And he's obviously heard about Jesus. There have been at least six occurrences of healing already, either individuals or groups of people, in this area of Galilee. And so you can imagine, when you look at a series of texts, it's probably about the trials and the following that was being generated. And so he's obviously heard about Jesus and his miracle working, and so he thinks he's got a 12-year-old girl to tell him. And so you can sense that he has, and so this is reaching out. Even though he's a synagogue leader, which would have created a little bit of an equivalent, because the synagogue was already, even at this early stage, turning against Jesus, and so he knew the establishment of the Sanhedrin, God is truthful, was already against Jesus. And you know yourself, if you've got a 12-year-old that's sick, you'll do anything to help him. And so he goes to get Jesus, and Jesus is now on his way to Jairus' house, when all of a sudden the second story begins to ensue, and this now is an elderly woman who has been in turning to Cleveland for 12 years. She's gone to doctors, she keeps getting relief. And so she too says that maybe this Jesus is the answer to her problem. And so she begins pushing her way through the crowd, and she touches the hem of his garment and is immediately healed. And Jesus says, "Who touched me?" And his disciples said, "Who touched me?" You're crowded around by people. It's like going into a sewer pit. At least when you can go to sewer pit. And she comes forward, embarrassed, obviously. She's probably trying to hide. And acknowledges that she was the one that touched his garment. Jesus says, "You're saved," and leaves him there. Now, Mary, who's watching all this, is sure she says, "Hey, don't stop. We don't have time to do it." But just at that point, they confirm you come from Jairus' house and they say, "Your daughter just died, and you can't bother to get the message to free." Jairus has a bit heartbroken at that point. But Jesus says something to it. Just believe. Just believe. He says to the woman, "Go, your faith has made you well." It's exactly the same word, just believe. And so he tells the thinking, what can Jesus possibly do in this situation? Because if the same one, they wouldn't desire to get there. They would have known to hire mourners, professional mourners. The idea was that you could just weep and wail. It would allow the family to grieve without embarrassment. And so they walk in and everyone's wailing and crying. And they say the girl's already died. Says, "You know, just go to sleep." And they all laugh at that. So Jesus gets the crowd out, takes Jairus and his wife, they go into the room of the little girl. And he takes her hand and says, "Little girl, I say, yeah." And immediately, the little girl gets up and begins walking around. And then he calls and he makes very few of these, whenever he does, you know, it's a good thing. He says, "And yet they were completely astounded." No kidding. "He just raised a little girl who was dead." And by the way, the story of the very thing that I asked ended with an editorial comment as well. "And all the people were amazed." Remember, that word "amazed" is how it happens about 15 times in the first chapter. Now, you see the thread that begins to connect these stories. Let me summarize it with a chart here. These are the next steps of power. On the left-hand column, you have the subtitles from the NIV of the snapshot that we're looking at. And that is what they point to. Jesus calming the storm points to Jesus' power over the forces of nature. Jesus restoring the kingdom to that man points to Jesus' power over the realm of evil. Jesus healing the sick one points to his power over the kingdom of Jesus raising the dead one points to his power over death. You think Mark is kind of grouping these stories together wonderfully? Or is there a pattern that creates a mosaic to what Mark wants us to actually see? Let's just get down a little deeper and try to appreciate how a first century Jew might have understood the significance of the standard story. We connect it to God, so we're going to dig down to it. Remember, when Jesus first saw the king in chapter 1, the king doing what? Announcing the kingdom of God has arrived. Unlike Matthew and Luke, he took several chapters to give interesting, you know, the genealogies, the birth narratives, and stuff like that. There is time for a simple part. He just jumps right in and says, Jesus came preaching the kingdom of God. That's the paragraph of the Bible. The Jewish mindset is that they thought in terms of this age and the age to come. This age was the present order of things. The coming was the redeemed order of the kingdom of God. The age to come is the word kingdom of God and the age to come is in the Jewish mindset. In the Old Testament prophets, they anticipated a new age in which the evils of the present age would be purged by a visitation of God. When God would bless us and save his creation, it would be this apocalyptic moment that would transform everything that it would have. Listen to this, a couple of these references to these kingdoms, the difference in the age to come, because the obligation to this is of the New Testament. Whoever speaks against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven, either in this age, or in the age to come. I think in Galatians, it says, the Lord Jesus, he himself, to rescue us from the present evil age. Notice, this age is characterized now as a evil age. In Romans, do not conform to the pattern of this age that can transform by the doing of your body. In Mark 4, Paul considered that last week. The worries of this age, the deceitfulness of wealth, choke out the word and make it fruitful. Matthew 13 is a series of seven parables in which Jesus is basically beginning to introduce this idea, which is what if the kingdom was going to break into this kind of Christian field visitation and everything was going to be transformed. I don't like the storyline sort of like as it was before. And so Jesus introduces every one of these parables by saying that the kingdom of heaven is one. In other words, I'm the kingdom of people. I will define how the kingdom is going to come in. Because it's coming in much differently than what you expected. Kind of like a song on Christmas, you know, how small it is. Now, the last parable Jesus says this is that chapter 13, verse 21. The first thing stands for the people of the kingdom. The weeds are the people of the evil one, and the harvest is the end of the age. And then 10 verses later, he says, this is how it will be at that fair point again. In other words, something. There's going to be a harvest. There's going to be a judgment. There's going to be this high-pointed inroad, but Jesus is introducing that as a slight change to the point. Now, let's summarize this in the text, too, so you can wrap your mind around it. Notice this area is the age of chaos, the disaster, the coming. The age to come will be an age of peace and calm, order and human flourishing. This age is an age of darkness and sin, becoming the age of life and righteousness. This age is an age of sickness, death, and mortality, becoming, and the age to come is restoration, life, and immortality. By the way, all the miracles are basically understood as miracles of restoration. What Jesus is doing is restoring things to the way they're supposed to be. He's restoring sight, he's restoring hearing, he's restoring people's functionality of limbs and so forth. And this is then the kingdom of Satan, but the peace to come is the kingdom of God. And this new kingdom, this new order, is going to be ushered in by an anointing of your faith. By the Messiah, that's what Moses wants to do, the Messiah. The kingdom of the kingdom. So when Jesus erupts on the scene, what does he do? He calls himself the light of the world. He warns against sin. He teaches about righteousness and holiness. He heals the sick. He raises the dead. He casts out demons. To see what it is. But it looks like a prophet. Both things that he seems to come. And if you want to take one example of what it seems to come with the deal. In Isaiah 35, it says this, be strong, do not fear, your God will come. Then, with the eyes of the blind be opened, and the ears of the deaf will be opened. Then the lame will leap like a deer, and the mute tongues will shout for joy, and the highway will be there, and it will be called the way of holiness, and it will be for those who walk in the way. You see the same kind of argument in the Baptist, when John the Baptist is in prison, and he hears about the teacher of Messiah. Remember, John the Baptist is Jesus' disciple. So he had a long history and a relationship with him, but he wasn't in the church. He didn't want to make a change. And so he says to his disciples, go and ask Jesus, are you the one who is to come? Or, we accept the mind. Notice these two reports. Go and report to God what you hear and see. The blind is the truth of the sight. The lame walk. Those who have leprosy are cleansed. The deaf hear. The dead are raised. And good news is they come to the kingdom. To hear the echoes of the miracle of God. Chapter later, Jesus uses this fourth point to argue. This one's perfect segue back into chapter 5 in the story of the Bible. He says, if it is by the Spirit of God that I drive out demons, then, in other words, what can Jesus do to the God? The kingdom of God. So, what was Mark is saying in these early chapters? Discipleship without mission is not biblical discipleship. It's not Jesus. walking into the disciple, you understand where Jesus is trying to take all of them. So, you can go to ask, okay, so how are you going to get people there? Now, watch Jesus' strategy. You ask the strategy question, so, okay, Jesus, how did you just make people who are going to sit to the school of the I would say, look, you get them out of the classroom, and you get them into the laboratory. You get them into practical opportunities and experiences. Now, look at transition. Chapter 4 is 85% parable, right? So, Jesus is teaching them, and his teaching was all about the kingdom of God, the nature of the kingdom. And you get to chapter 5, what does he do? He lets them experience the kingdom of God. He demonstrates the kingdom of God. It's a short-term mission project. That's what's going on. Next, if you go for it, so let's put up this map. And I want you to notice, you can see it down with it. And up here is the turn at the top. This is about 13 miles by 8 miles wide. Anyway, the Lake Chicago is on the summer front. The Lake Chicago is 17 miles wide, but only 2 miles across. There's no Lake Chicago. There's some similarities there to those combined supplies. Now, the chapter begins by saying, and Jesus took them to the other side. Now, the other side becomes a metaphor for a place that's boring, a little bit different, kind of outside of their comfort zone. Jesus' ministry to this point has been focused right here in the town of Capernaum and in this larger area of Galilee. Okay, that was Gentile territory. But when it says Jesus took them to the other side, what's going to happen is they're going to come, you know, right down the Sea of Galilee. Right about here, they think was the storm at sea, and then they get down here to an area called the Gadarenes or the Gerasenes. And that is the other side. All of a sudden, what's happening? The disciples are now not in Jewish territory anymore, but they're in Gentile territory. And if you even set foot in a Gentile house, you were declared unclean. So you can imagine the sense of angst that these disciples are feeling. Three times in chapter 4 and chapter 5, we talk about going to the other side. So all of a sudden, they're a Gentile, unclean character. They're met by an unclean man. That's the way he's described. And he lives among the Jews. And what's the high form of contamination and Jewish uncleanliness? You're taking his voice, taking his dead body. You couldn't even turn it over or try to get a pulse without being declared unclean and having to go through ritual purification. Unclean territory, an unclean man from unclean tombs approaches them possessed of all things called unclean spirits. And right on the other side of the hill is what? Two of the high priests. One reason to go to Gentile territory. Two don't eat pork. Why? They're unclean. So, I mean, this whole story is just dripping with uncleanness. And you can just feel the sense of angst that these disciples are experiencing. But many people will tell you that if, when they got outside of their comfort zone, it is where they really began to grow. I know myself, when I was an undergraduate in West Virginia, I had a friend who was an international student. Actually, I bought my head to pray at the cafeteria of the dorm room. As soon as I looked up, there was a guy standing. And he said, "Are you a believer?" He said, "Yes." His name was Bozo. I thought he said, "No one could pronounce his name in that way." So we all called him Bozo. And Bozo became one of my best friends during those years. And I think I put him in my life. He said, this guy was an evangelist. I mean, he just loved to share Christ. And so he would say, "Hey, let's go out and just, you know, say that I go because, you know, I kind of like Bozo. He's a great guy. He's doing the graduate student in engineering." So we would, you know, we would chat with him. One day he comes to me and says, "He said, I've got an idea." He said, "All these international students that he has, he's part of the international student club." He said, "They're so lonely." And he said, "If we were just kind of put together some kind of dinner and bring in a speech," he said, "I think we could get a bunch of them to go to our pastor. We come to share this with the pastor, and of course, he loves it. Pastors are supposed to love this kind of stuff, right? And he used to be a missionary. And so we will not only host this event, we will cover the expenses of the volunteers that will take care of the cooking and so forth. And
I'm going to go to the next slide. I'm involved with an emergency call firm from Tailway on Central Street in Tailway. So, just to let you know, not from Julie, but from the emergency in the hospital, to do a study that I have
and so, to find us, we'll take care of it. But whoever is in chapter 3, he chose well that they might be with him. In other words, he forsook this large public ministry. Focuses efforts on smaller groups of relationships. In this case, that is Christ. But in chapter 5, what we see is, notice that verse 5:37, he gave extra measures and kinds of attention to the three, the subgroups of Peter, James, and John. And you'll see that pattern in Scripture where a lot of things, Jesus took Peter, James, and John, and off to the book. But it is obvious that, Jesus focused his efforts even more finely on these three, and it is interesting to go through the principles of the Council of the Apostles. We see that chapter 4, there's a good reminder that Jesus' model of discipleship was to, in large part, forsake the crowds into the more expensive public ministry, to focus his time in those three middle categories, social, personal, and intimate, which is Jesus' ministry would have been the 70, the 12, the 6, and 50. Just as many of you are invited to the Lord and say it, the benefits of the challenges is that there's triads and four tests that are recorded by the first of all, they're the most transformative. Why? Because you can't hide it. It's a physical effect. It's lifelong life interaction. You have to be more engaged than you are in a small group. And there's small people that get to the house. It's more open, or tends to be more open, more vulnerable to the kids, because you're in the same gender group. The key to transformation, remember, is true plus equals transformation. So you need the Bible, you need its application, but you need a climate of transparency, vulnerability, and openness, which happens best in smaller settings. You can impress people from a distance, you see, with ideas, with words, but you influence them up close and personal. So that's the benefit of the micro group. Here's the challenge, but also the most difficult. Why? Because it's lifelong life interaction, because you're more open, vulnerable, and transparent. You come face to face with each other's quirks and flaws and weaknesses and their strengths as well. It has the greatest potential to impact, but it also has the greatest potential to harm. It's a different point. The greatest potential to heal, and the greatest potential to hope. I will lay down my life for you. He also provides me something. Do that. And all the disciples are deservable. Now, here's the key to what happens a little later in the story. It says, after the resurrection, Jesus said, go tell my disciples to meet me. Go tell my disciples and Peter. Why did he get out on the Jewish and Peter? Because Peter would have been beating himself up saying, I can't believe it. Here's one final verse, which says, have to see the importance of the relationship to the disciples. Paul goes on, as the Bible is describing kind of a relationship with the community. And Barnabas was part of that as well. They did a lot of missionary travels together. Was part of the Pentecostal group, if you will. And later, Timothy is now a pastor in the church, and Paul writes to it in chapter 3 of 2 Timothy, verses 10 through 12. He says, "You, however, know all about my teaching." But he doesn't start there. He goes on to say, "My way of life, my purpose, faith, patience, love, endurance, persecution, suffering." Why? Because there are a lot of things you see that are taught, not just there are a lot of things that we learn, you know, not from simply a person's teaching, but up close and personal. From their life. So then you can impress people with different things with the relationship. So here's two action steps that I like to speak to. Number one, get into some spiritually strategic relationships where you can be open, vulnerable, and transparent. And get into scripture, make sure that scripture is getting into you. Formula for transformation is truth plus transparency equals transformation. And secondly, be involved in some of the other side projects. Go to our website, check them out, see what looks interesting, discuss it with your high school group, your small group, and make that call and get signed up in the next couple of weeks before you do your call to take people into that kind of experience to continue their life. Father, thank you for your word. The way it speaks to us at so many levels. The stand of God and Jesus and the wonder of his power over the nature of evil and disease and death. The way we get to know you more than you do is to trust you. The way we get to the steps that the Lord has given us that just requires that we are who you are. Thank you for these practical steps where that we can apply to our own discipleship and efforts to disciple others. Thank you for the good news of the gospel of the kingdom that we are not left to our own devices, but that you will come alongside us to draw us up with the power to follow you, to be pleased by you, and to draw our nations